right, if you'll stand with me and turn to page 232, we're going to sing Tell Me the Story of Jesus. We'll sing all three verses, page 232.
Reality, but I'm glad this dream began. Judges chapter number 18, if you've got your Bible with you tonight, we're going to read through 18 and jump into 19, and we'll have one more spot tonight afterwards, and that'll be in Romans. So if you want to go ahead and maybe put your pinky over there, or if you've got one of those Bible tabs, it seems like I never have enough tabs. Amen. I wish they put more tassels on the Bible. I wish I had more of them. But put your tassel there maybe in Romans, because we're going to be there here in just a moment. But Judges chapter number 18 is where we're going to begin. And the thought for tonight is a simple thought, but life with no king. It's very interesting, the book of Judges, where we find the children of Israel. They found the promised land. Obviously, they've been through the wilderness. They experienced the death of Moses. They then experienced the passing of that authority from Moses to Joshua. And then, of course, God's leading and God's guiding of Joshua and the people into the land. And then we find the people, after Joshua dies, here in the book of Judges, completely and totally seemingly lost. In fact, as you look through the book of Judges, it's like a roller coaster. I've said that many times. You would read and say, man, what in the world is going on with these people? Just up and down, and they're everywhere. It seems like they just cannot figure things out. And so, you know, it's very interesting to read and kind of diagnose what this problem is and why they're having this problem. The key verse for Judges would be that every man did that which was right in his own eyes. It says that in chapter number 17 and verse number 6. It says it right there on the page. It says, in those days there was no king in Israel, but every man did that which was right in his own eyes. And so that's kind of this theme that we find here in Judges, is that every man is really just doing what's right in their own eyes. Now, you and I have talked about sin, and you and I know who we can trust as far as it comes to sin. We talked about just a few weeks ago the Word of God and how we can try our emotions, we can try our feelings, we can try the different things that come in and out of our thoughts by God's Word, right? And we can know whether it is or isn't sin. Again, and we can run everything through God's Word to kind of get an honest answer. On the flip side of that, you and I know that our natural state and who we are naturally, we cannot trust. The Bible says that the heart is wicked, right? And who can know it, right? The heart is wicked. No man truly knows his heart or could ever know how wicked that thing or how far that thing could really go. Our hearts are just wicked. There's no way around it. And so, again, it's no wonder we find here in the book of Judges that the people of Israel are completely and totally, utterly lost following the things that they believe is right in their own eyes. So look at this in chapter 18 and verse number 1. We're going to read, and then we're going to look at the flip side of this here in just a moment. It says this, in those days, there was no king in Israel. Again, it states it over and over throughout this book of Judges. In those days, there was no king in Israel, and in those days, the tribe of the Danites sought them to the an inheritance to dwell in. For unto that day all their inheritance had not fallen unto them among the tribes of Israel. And the children of Dan set their family, five men from their coats, men of valor, from Zorah and Eshtatol, to spy out the land and to search it. And they said unto them, go search the land, who, when they came to the Mount Ephraim, and the Mount, to the house of Micah where they lodged, when they were by the house of Micah, they knew the voice of the young man, the Levite. And they turned in thither and said unto him, who brought thee hither? And what makest thou in this place? And what hast thou here? And he said unto them, thus and thus dealeth Micah with me, and he hath hired me. I am his priest. And they said unto him, ask counsel, we pray thee, of God, that we may know whether our way, which we shall go, be prosperous. And the priest said unto them, go in peace before the Lord is your way wherein you go. And then the five men departed and came to Laish and saw that the people were therein, how they dwelt careless after the manner of the Zidianites, quiet and secure, and there was no magistrate in the land that they might put them to shame in anything. And they were far from the Zidianites and had no business with any man. And they came unto their brethren, unto Zorah, to Eshtol, and their brethren said unto them, What say ye? And they said, Arise, that we may go up against them, for we have seen the land, and behold, it is very good. Are ye still? Be not slothful to go and to enter and to possess the land. When you go, ye shall come unto a people secure into a large land, for God hath given it into your hands, a place where there is no want of anything that is in the earth. And there went from thence of the family of the Danites out to Zorah and Eshtol 600 men appointed with weapons of war, and they went up and pitched in Kirjath Jearim in Judah. Wherefore they called the place, and I can't pronounce the name, Mahanithim. Unto this day, behold, it is behind Kirjath Jearim. And they passed thence about Mount Ephraim and came unto the house of Micah. Then answered the five men that went to spy out the country to Laish, and said unto the other brethren, Do we know that there is in these houses an ephod and a teraphim and a graven image and a molten image? Now therefore consider what ye have to do. And so again, they go over some of this journey and these Levites. And so we're going to skip ahead just a couple verses. And to verse number 30, it says, And the children of Dan set up the graven image, and Jonathan the son of Gershom, the son of Manasseh, he and his sons were priests of the tribe of Dan till the day of the captivity of the land. And they set them up Micah's graven image, which he had made all the time in the house of God was in Shiloh. Which brings us into chapter number 19. And so these people were sent, and it says in chapter number 19 and verse number 1, And it came to pass in those days when there was no king in Israel. Again, it's just going to repeat this over and over. That there was a certain Levi sojourning on the side of Mount Ephraim who took to him a concubine of Bethlehem Judah. And his concubine played the whore against him and went away from him unto her father's house to Bethlehem Judah and was there 4 whole months. And her husband arose and went after her to speak friendly unto her and bring her again, having his servant with him and a couple of asses. And she brought him into her father's house. And when the father of the damsel saw him, he rejoiced to meet him. And his father-in-law, the damsel's father, retained him, and he abode with him 3 days so that they did eat and drink and lodge there. And so, again, it starts to tell the story of this Levite man. And, of course, his wife is not faithful and runs away. The Bible says a whole 4 months, which is a long time. And so he goes after her. He's going to begin to pursue her. And we're going to see him with his father-in-law and this kind of this back and forth that these two share in verse number 5. And it came to pass on the 4th day when they arose early in the morning that he rose up to depart. The damsel's father said unto his son-in-law, Comfort thine heart with a morsel of bread, and afterward go your way. And they sat down and did eat and drink, both of them together. For the damsel's father had said unto the man, Be content, I pray thee, and tarry all night, and let thy heart be merry. And when the man arose to depart, his father-in-law urged him. Therefore he lodged there again. And he rose early in the morning on the 5th day to depart. And the damsel's father said, Comfort thy heart, I pray thee. And they tarried until the afternoon. And they did eat, both of them. And when the man arose up to depart, he and his concubine and his servant and his father-in-law, the damsel's father said unto him, Behold, now the day draweth toward evening. I pray you tarry all night. Behold, the day groweth to an end. Lodge here, that thine heart be merry, and tomorrow get you early on your way, that thou mayest go home. And I don't know about you, but if you've ever stayed at the in-law's house, this is sometimes how it feels, right? You get there and you stay a little bit. I'm just teasing. My in-laws are great. They have great food, and they're wonderful people. In fact, that's one of my favorite things about my father-in-law is the fact that he is, he's like a chef. He can make anything in the world. So every time we go, he's got steak and all kinds of cuts of meat. I love staying at their house, but they just would not let him go, right? He kept saying, stay and comfort your heart and stay and comfort your heart. Lodge here and, oh, it's getting late. Stay here, right? And, you know, Michelle is Amanda's mom, and she's one of those people that is just so comforting, right? She wants everybody to be comfortable and everybody to be homey, right? And she's always in that mindset of doing those things. She says that all the time. I'm getting ready to go home. We've got that 2-hour drive back to Batavia, right? And just stay here tonight. Just sleep. No, I'm not sleeping here and waking up at 4 a.m. to get back. And I'm going home, right? And so I can only imagine that's what this guy's thinking is, I'm going home. I'm going to grab her and we're leaving and we're not staying another night, right? Stop asking me. It says this. It says in verse number 11, And when they were by Jabez, the day was far spent, and the servant said unto his master, Come, I pray thee, and let us turn into this city of the Jebusites and lodge in it. In verse number 12, And his master said unto him, We will not turn aside hither into the city of a stranger that is not of the children of Israel. We will pass over unto Gibeah. And he said unto his servant, Come, and let us draw near to one of these places to lodge all night in Gibeah or in Ramah. And they passed on and went their way, and the sun went down upon them when they were by Gibeah, which belongeth to Benjamin. And so now they're journeying. They're going to go, again, not to a land where they're strangers. He says, don't Don't camp in a land of strangers. Let's get to a place that we're familiar with, right, where we're among the children of Israel. So they go. Now they're in Gibeah, which, again, the Bible says belongeth to Benjamin. In verse number 15, they turn aside thither to go in and to lodge in Gibeah. And when he went in, he sat down in the street of the city, for there was no man that took them into the house to lodge. And behold, there came an old man from his work out of the field at even, which was also of Mount Ephraim, and sojourned in Gibeah. But the men of the place were Benjamites. And when he had lifted up his eyes, he saw a wayfaring man in the street of the city. And the old man said, Whither goest thou, and whence comest thou? And he said unto him, We are passing from Bethlehem, Judah, toward the side of Mount Ephraim, and from thence am I. And I went down to Bethlehem, Judah, but I am now going to the house of the Lord. And there is no man that receiveth me to house. Yet is both straw and provender for our asses, and there is bread and wine also for me, and for thy handmaid, and for thy young man, which is with thy servants, there is no want of anything. And the old man said, Peace be with thee, howsoever, let all thy wants lie upon me, only lodge not in the street. And so this man is going to do a seemingly good thing, right? He finds some strangers that he doesn't know, and he says, Well, you know, don't lay here in the streets. I've got a place for you, and I've got some provision. Come stay the night with me, right? Just come on home. And again, nowadays that doesn't fly, but back then, right, that would have been something that was much appreciated, something that was a good gesture. And so again, he's doing something that seemingly is a good thing. It says this in verse number 21, so he brought them into his house and gave provender unto the asses, and they washed their feet and did eat and drink. It says in verse number 22, now as they were making their hearts merry, behold, the men of the city, certain sons of Belial, beset the house round about, and beat at the door, and spake to the master of the house, the old man, saying, Bring forth the man that came into thine house, that we may know him. Verse number 23, and the man, the master of the house, went up out unto them, and said unto them, Nay, my brethren, nay, I pray you, do not so wickedly, seeing that this man is come into mine house, do not this folly. Now again, I know what you're thinking. My first thought was, man, didn't this happen before, or doesn't this at least sound like another Bible story? And the answer would be yes. It sounds almost identical, right, to Lot, when the men of the city surrounded Lot's house and they said, Bring us out those two angels, right? It was two angels that time that came down to Lot. He said, Bring us out those two angels, right, that, you know, blah, 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 that they do their thing. And Lot said, No, right? And so, again, this is the second time now that we're hearing kind of this same circumstance that a man has journeyed into this city, and now these men, a different city, a different place, but now these men are requiring that that man be brought back out again for the wickedness of their sin. And he says this, and the master of the house went out and said, Nay, I pray, do not so wickedly, saying that this man has come to my house, do not this folly. Behold, here is my daughter, a maiden, and his concubine. Them I will bring out now, and humble ye them, and do what seemeth good unto you, but unto this man do no vile thing. But the men would not hearken to him. So the men took his concubine and brought her forth unto them, and they knew her and abused her all night until the morning. And when the day began to spring, they let her go. Then came the woman in the dawning of the day and fell down at the door of the man's house where her lord was till it was light. And her lord rose up in the morning and opened the doors of the house and went out to go his way. Behold, the woman, his concubine, was fallen down at the door of the house, and her hands were upon the threshold. And he said unto her, Up and let us be going. But none answered. The man took her upon an ass, and the man rose up and gat him into his place. And when he was come into his house, he took a knife and laid hold on his concubine and divided her together with her bones into 12 pieces and sent her into all the coasts of Israel. Now, stop for just a moment, okay, because there's a show on TV called Criminal Minds, right? And there's also CSI and all those different. And that's what I feel like when I'm reading this portion of Scripture. I stop and I read. I'm like, what in the world am I reading, right? I'm reading about this gruesome, awful act, right, that is recorded in God's Word. And so often, right, we paint the picture that God's Word is only good and only great, right, and only good things happen in the Bible. And it's all love and comfort and peace and joy and all those different things, when the Bible records a lot of awful things. In fact, we're reading about one of them right now, an awful, awful, awful thing that happened. And again, these men were so wicked and these men were so encompassed in their own ways that what's happened now is they've literally abused this woman to the point of death. Notice this, after the night of all that abuse, right, the master walks out the next day, sees her on the doorstep, and what does he say? Up. Now, can you imagine, right? I mean, it's not enough that she was abused and that she was outside and all these different things, and we won't go into any of that, but it's not enough that she had just been tormented. But the next thing he says to her, he looks down at her estate and says that she was on the ground and her hands were on the threshold. He says, up, right? Get up. What are you doing laying there? Get up so we can go and we can do. And it says, none answered, right? It becomes very clear at this point in the Bible that this woman had obviously passed because of all the different things that happened to her. And so what's happened at this point is what you're seeing is the result of Israel with no king. What you're seeing is men left to their own ways. And what they've done is now they've executed this evil to the point where this woman has literally lost her life, right? She has literally, her life has been taken from her as a consequence of all this sin that this city has allowed. Now, again, this is not Sodom. This is not Sodom and Gomorrah. This is a different story. This is the children of Israel. This is one of their cities. Again, just a moment ago, we said it's Gibeah, right, which belongeth to Benjamin. So this is one of their cities. This is inside of God's people's land where this is happening. And so what we're seeing is the very evidence of a country or a people with no king. Now, let's stop right there for just a moment before we go any further, and we're going to read just a little bit more and get through this story. But something about the children of Israel that most people don't know is this, that they were supposed to be a peculiar people. In fact, they were supposed to be a people that didn't need a king. They were supposed to follow God. God's original plan for his children was that they would not have a ruler. They would not have a king. They would not have somebody setting over them. So it makes it very interesting when you read, and it says in those days there was no king, right? It goes over and over that there was no king. And again, what I think it's trying to remind you and me, and I think what the Bible is saying here is that God was completely removed from his throne in the children of Israel's life. And so I said at the beginning that the title of our message is Life Without the King. And of course, we don't mean a physical ruler king, but of course we mean God. What does life look like without God? What does life look like without the king? And again, I think that you and I very easily can look not even far out into our world and realize what life without the king really looks like. What life without God looks like when men and women are left to their own ways and their own devices and the own imaginations of their hearts. You see it over and over and over in God's word. What happens when you and I are left to being guided by our own heart? I'll remind you, just back in chapter number 17, it said that each and every man did right which was in his own eyes. They did what they legitimately thought was right, right? They did what they thought was right. They weren't acting maliciously. They were doing what they thought was right. And so again, over and over and over, Scripture demands that there be something outside of you and me that would be a governing, right, force or a governing entity that would allow you and I to live in a way that isn't left to our own flesh or isn't left to our own lust, so the different things that our flesh works. And so here was God's plan originally for the children of Israel, that he would be enough, that he would be the provision, that they could simply go to him, or that they could inquire of him, or that they could take all their matters before him or his word and be able to judge the different things that were going on by what God had given to them and by the different ways that he communicated with them, right? Through prophets and all those different things. And so that was supposed to be enough. But again, what's happened is these children of Israel have left that satisfaction they found in God, and now they're doing what's right in their own eyes. But here's the problem. At the end of that trail, whether you were successful in it, or whether you enjoyed it, or whether you revel in it, or whatever it is, you'll always find truth. No matter how long you go, and no matter how far you go, and all those different things, you'll always find in the end, it doesn't work. And I don't care who they are, I don't care what they're doing, I don't care how successful they are, at the end of their life, or at the end of whatever road they're marching down, when they realize their sin is wrong, they will find truth, and that is that these different things bring death. They bring destruction. All sin leads to the same place. And so here's what we find. So this woman is abused all night on the doorstep. Master wakes up, walks outside, says, get up. She doesn't get up. He realizes she's been abused to the point where now she's dead. And so he's angry. He's going to realize that this city is wicked. He's going to realize how far these children of Israel have gone, right? He realizes just how far that sin has gone and what it has now cost him as far as, you know, that regard goes. So what he's going to do is something, again, that we look at and say, man, this is straight out of a movie or a horror film or something like that. And the Bible says not to be crude or not to be graphic, but it says that he cut her up into pieces, right, into 12 different pieces. Of course, we know that 12 is the number of tribes that there are in Israel. And he sends her out in these pieces to all these different tribes. And he says, listen, man, this is what's going on in this place. This is what's going on in this country. This is what's happening under our rule, not God's rule. And here, friend, is the reminder. This is the reminder is that life without a king will always lead to destruction. The children of Israel were always supposed to be satisfied with God. They were always supposed to follow God. They were always supposed to, right, stay within God's confines for who they would be and what they should do. They should have never experienced this part of life, which is what brings me to my next point is this, that we get so upset with God due to the condition of our world. And God says, no, 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 you were never supposed to make it that far. You were never supposed to go that far. Your sin was never supposed to reach that point where now there are physical consequences, where now there are things happening because of how far you've gone into your sin, right? When God has saved us, when the Holy Spirit moved inside of us, what that was, it was a turning point, or it should have been a turning point in your and I's life. That now we're something different because of Jesus inside of us. I'm not going to be the same as I was before. And so again, just the same way that the Holy Spirit lives inside of us, God was leading his children. He says, you should have never made it to that point where now this is a part of who you are. Now this is happening in your very own cities. Again, I think that we can look at churches and say, man, there's things happening inside the church. I talked about just a few weeks ago that Bibles and bourbon, right? That get together that they have, they get together and they drink and they go through God's word. I have no idea what they're learning in that Bible study, right? As soon as that alcohol hits the belly, who knows what's being said about God's word? If they're even reading God's word, I have no idea. Who knows, right? We've allowed all kinds of things into God's own house. And you look at churches all around the world and what they're doing inside of God's house, truly, it's despicable what we've allowed the church become, what we've allowed ourselves to become, right, which eventually led to what the church has become. Again, it's so easy for us to get upset and get mad, but you look at God's people, and here they are. They should have had everything they needed in a king, and then can't we very easily draw the line and say, man, we should have had everything we needed in a Savior. We should have had everything we needed in King Jesus, that we've not allowed all these different things, again, to come to fruition in your and I's lives. And so again, I think that that's why we see a lot of the different things that we see in life. Okay, now I said hold your place here. Go to Romans quickly in chapter number 7. I'm sorry, number 6. And we're going to be in verse number 11. And we're going to read a few verses and we'll flip back in just a moment. But the Bible says this. Likewise, reckon ye also yourselves to be dead indeed unto sin, but alive unto God through Jesus Christ our Lord. And then it says this in verse number 12, let not sin therefore reign in your mortal body, that ye should obey in the lust thereof. Neither yield ye your members as instruments of unrighteousness unto sin, but yield yourselves unto God as those that are alive from the dead, and your members as instruments of righteousness unto God. And so here's what the Bible is saying. Here's what the Bible is recording for us. There is a difference between what's dead and what's alive, right? The moment that you and I got saved, now we were delivered from that which was dead. So by all means and by all intents and purposes, you and I should be alive. We should look different. Something that's alive looks very different than something that's dead, right? You've seen flowers that were alive next to flowers that were dead. At Hillsboro, somebody was spraying weeds, and the sprayer got away from a little bit, and it picked up and hit one of the trees. And there was a very big difference between the pine trees that were really nice and green and shaped and really good looking, and then that one brown, ugly, dead one right in the middle of all of them, right? You could see it. Every time you looked at those trees, one of them was just smacked. It was dead. It was just dead, right? So there should be a very obvious difference between something that's dead and something that's alive. And here's the difference. The world without the king is death. The world's consequence without the king is death. What the world will bring about without the king is death. You see how all roads lead to death without the king? It's true for every person that's ever lived in the world. You say, man, that is not a very uplifting message. Well, you're right. If you're going to stop in Judges and say, that's it, right? Every road leads to death, and we'll never do anything right, and we're always going to do things that are right in our own eyes, we're never going to go anywhere. But then the Bible in Romans lays out a completely different, separate life. And it begins to introduce to us this concept of, well, we can have a ruler in our life that literally makes the difference in all of these things. And see, this is where we're going to settle in our message tonight. Jesus moves in, not only inside of us, but now he becomes that king in your and I's life. What is the significance of that? Here's the significance. God has now taken something that was dead and only leads to death, and now he's given it the viable option of life. He's given you and I an option or a reason, right, to live rather than to perish like the rest of the world. In other words, watch what he says here in verse number 13. It says this, neither yield ye your members as instruments of unrighteousness unto sin, but watch what it says in this verse, in the latter part of this verse, but yield yourselves unto God as those that are alive from the dead. And so here's what he says, when you yield yourself to God, when you stop and you allow your emotions and your wants and all your desires to yield, and you yield yourself to God, right, then what that brings in is it brings in life. It's a different life than what you and I had before. If you drive, right, you know the exit ramps or the entrance ramps, right? And when you've got two coming the same way, somebody has to yield. I remember back in Marysville, there was one as you got on 36 that absolutely, or 33, absolutely nobody. It's like that sign was never put there. Everybody tried to get on the highway the exact same. I'm telling you, it was a disaster, right? Things don't work when you don't yield, right? You got lots of accidents and lots of problems. Somebody has to yield. The same thing happens in your and I's life. There's two different vehicles trying to get in the same lane at the same time. That's what happens when you and I are not giving God his proper place in our lives. The Bible says yield, right? That we be yielded to God, meaning I stop and I let him progress. And so from my life, when I got saved, now it should be Jesus living through me, not me living through myself anymore. Now my body is not mine, but Jesus lives through me. And so now we've gone from life without a king. We see the results of that in Judges, and you even see it in the book of Kings when they have a king. You see the multiple relapses of their faith and all these different pitfalls they fall. You see the effects of what sin does when there is no king versus this life that God intended you and I to live, which of course is a life with the king. He always intended for his people to have a king. You notice as you read, you go back and you look at these children of Israel, God said, I was always there. I can only imagine. God says, I was always there. From the beginning, I was there. From you, from me delivering Moses, right, out of the river, I was there. From me growing Moses and speaking to him as a burning bush and putting the burden on his heart to go to Pharaoh, I was there. And then when he had a contest with Pharaoh, I was there. And when he led you and you went through the wilderness and all these people chased you, I was there through every single step. And I was also there when I brought you into the promised land. And that was always supposed to be enough. That was always supposed to be enough to govern his people. You see, here you and I are in life, and sometimes you and I live like there is no king. Sometimes we allow our lives to be run like Jesus is not supreme, like we still live in our flesh. When the Bible says that we ought to be yielded to God, allowing him to live through us. And here's what happens is God, when we yield ourselves to him, then he steps in and does what only he can do, and that is lead us anywhere else but death. He leads us anywhere else in the world but death. And when you follow God and when you follow Christ and when that is your path, death is no longer the destination. You see, the whole world is destined for death. The whole world is condemned to die. Again, not very encouraging, but the encouragement is that Jesus came and now they have an alternate route. You and I have an alternate route. And so here's what God says. Let me be enough. Amen? Isn't that essentially what he says? Let me be enough. Allow me to be those things in your life. Allow me to be the happiness. Allow me to be the contentment. Allow me to be the joy. Allow me to be the peace. Allow God to be king in your life. Watch this, because he's there. But just because he's there doesn't mean he's on your throne. So listen to this, which brings us to our last category of people, is people who are saved. They've got access to the king, but they don't allow the king to sit on the throne. And listen, friends, so many of us are saved. We've been born again. We've got the Holy Spirit of God living inside of us. But we don't give God that seat in our life. We try to sit in that seat. We try to maintain control. We try to maintain possession of our life when really Jesus is the only one that belongs in that seat. Really, the Lord God himself is the only one that belongs in that seat. He's the one that needs to lead. He's the one that needs to bring us through the different things we go through in life. And so here, I can only imagine, after going through all these things with his children, you know, God is forced to allow things to come upon them. He's forced to allow them to fall into enemy hands and to be reconciled over and over again. I can only imagine God's frustration with his people. I can only imagine why, because he's always been there. He was always right next to them. And here's the thing, if they would have just opened their eyes and looked to him, they could have avoided all these different situations. And how many times in life has God been right there? How many different times in life has God been right there? If we'd have just stopped and opened our eyes and realized, God, you were all over it. And God, you were orchestrating all the things that were happening. God was always there and always has been there and always will be there. So here's the thought, friend. So instead of living life without the king, let's realize God is always going to be enough, and let's allow him to be king in our lives. And when you and I allow Jesus to have his rightful place in our life, listen, friend, that's when we see success. That's when we see life at its fullest. You see, the world preaches that's death. The world preaches that's limitation. That's slavery. That's a cult. You ever been called a cult as a church? That's a cult. Why would you do that? Why would you give yourself to, why would you shut yourself off from all this pleasure and all these? Because we know it's life. And when you allow the king to have that spot in your life, you allow Jesus to have that throne, you'll truly experience life. And we talked about just a few weeks ago, time. You only get this thing one time. Amen? You only get this life one time. And so, friend, don't live it for the world. Really live life. And allow God to live through you. Everything you say, everything you do, every facet of your life, allow God to grow up. Something very interesting is this, that when plants and different things die, right, if they're burnt up, their ashes become what? They become fertilizer, right? They become fertilizer for that ground. And what grows up out of that death? Life. After that thing's burned down, or after that thing dies, right, it goes into the ground, becomes fertilizer, and then new life comes. And so, listen, let the whole old life melt away. Let all of that turn to ash and allow Jesus to grow up what he really wants to be a part of your and I's life, because he's trying to do it. And don't take the bad times and don't take the lessons that God's trying to teach you and take them the wrong way and not learn, but rather learn those lessons and allow God to grow you and see where God really wants to take you. Because here's the truth, God is still protecting his people, Israel, today. Isn't he? God is still protecting them today. And even after they lost, and man, they lost so many battles, and they were scattered, God brought them back to be a nation again. And God is still protecting, God is still leading, God is still guiding, even after all of those mistakes. I remember hearing a story that somebody launched missiles. Did I tell you this already? Somebody launched missiles into Israel. Right? And this leader afterwards, of course, none of the missiles hit, nobody was killed, nothing happened. This leader said, man, I know their God is real because those missiles just stopped. They were going, they were on target, and they just stopped. He said, we have no explanation but other than God is protecting his people. And you know what? When Israel looked up to its king, every time you read through Judges, every time you read through the book of Kings, every time Israel looks up to its king, God is faithful and God is just to deliver them out of what they're going through. And so listen, friend, maybe you simply just need to look up. Maybe you simply need to realize, I've been living life without a king, and I need to start living life like there's a king. I need to start allowing Jesus to be king in my life. And I'll tell you this from my own personal experience. Again, I've not been on earth long, but the majority of my life was spent outside of the will of God. I have never been more happy than being in the will of God. I've never been more successful. I've never been more peaceful. I've never been more rested. I've never had what I have now outside of God and outside of having the King in my life. Amen? And that's how God wants us to live. That's how God wants us to endure. And so listen, friend, look up and simply realize the King is there. He's always been there. And that's his desire, is to be king. Amen. Isn't he best at it? Amen. Rather than letting somebody else do it, allow him to be king. So life without the king, life with the king. God was always there. That was always his plan. Allow him to be king. Every head bowed, every eye closed, we'll stand, we'll pray. We'll conclude this evening's service. Lord, I know that there were so many years in which I did not know you. God, so many years in which I wasted my life in sin and trouble, all the different things of the world. And then, God, I remember getting saved. I remember you entering my life, and God, I remember a drastic difference. I remember, God, you changing everything about my life. And God, I've personally experienced life without a king, and God, I've personally experienced life with you as the king. And God, there's a clear winner. There's one path that doesn't lead to death. And so, God, as we read your word and study, help us, Lord, to draw these truths from your word and then apply them to our life. Because the reality is, we'll read this, we'll hear this, but when trials come, we'll rely on ourselves. When trials come, we'll rely on the world and not on you. And so, God, in our lives, help us to make you king. God, as a church, we want you to be king. God, as a church, we want you to lead. And God, we want you to have the forefront. And so, Lord, allow us to give those things to you. And God, humble our hearts. Lord, if we've been those that have kept that place from you, you belong on the throne. And God, all the hardship and all the things the children of Israel went through, I can only imagine all of that could have been avoided if they'd have just realized who you were in their life. And God, I don't want to go through unnecessary trials. I don't want to go through different things in life simply because I didn't see you as king. So God, be king of my life. Be king, and God, have your will and your way in my life. Lead me wherever you'd have me to go. Have me to do whatever you have me to do. I surrender my life to you and give it to you as king. And so Lord, the same way that we surrender our individual lives to you, we surrender this church to you. God, we ask that you have your will and your way with your people. In Jesus' name we pray. Every head bowed, every eye closed, as we're sharing our final words. The Lord is dealing with our hearts. If there's a place in life where God has spoken to you, would you come? Simply put, would you come? God says, man, maybe I haven't been king in your life, or maybe you've not given this area to me, would you come? God says, I desire to be king in your life. God wants to be king in your life. Things to do is to sit and watch as the people you love make mistakes and get hurt because of the things that could have been avoided. And God sits and watches, just waiting to be king. And so tonight, let's end all the silly trials. Let's end all the silly things in life. And let's give it all to God so he can be king and so that we can truly live this life way that God intends it to be lived. And so if God has spoken to your heart tonight, would you come? People are at the altar right now, you come. I'm going to bow and I'm going to pray. As I bow, you come. we conclude this evening, I'll tell you this, I'm excited for next week. I really am. I know what I'm preaching already. I'm excited. I'm excited for the future and what the Lord's going to bring. And you say, man, I'm so tired of hearing about sin. Listen, I'm so tired of preaching about sin. Amen. But you know what? It's something that we're going to deal with for our whole life. And as I read through the Bible, man, there's uplifting messages. There's things in there. But I tell you what, the majority of it is all warnings. The majority of it is all things that could have been avoided if we just turned to God first. And so listen, don't be discouraged by the fact that we talk about sin, but rather be encouraged that there's a flip side to that sin. Amen. And that we can avoid those things that come because of it. And there's a life that God wants us to live. And so let's be encouraged by that, dwell in that, and not force God to bring some of these different things on us. Bruce, would you make our prayer tonight as we close, please?
Kind of gracious Lord Father, I want to thank you for the opportunity to come to your house to worship. I want to thank you for everything that you've done in our lives. I pray that you'll be with those who are unable to tend you to sickness, that you'll just lift them up and bring them back to us. I pray that you'll be with each and everyone that's here, that you'll just guide them and direct them throughout the remainder of the week, and travel in mercy's home, and just watch over us and continue to lead and guide us in all things. We pray these things in Jesus' name.
Amen. Thank you for this message.